أنشدت بسم الله ثم الحمد له فالله أهل الحمد إن الحمد له يا ربي أنت كلما رزقتني رأيت خيرا سابغا لحد له بك الرجاء وحبكم ربي سرى في القلب ثم زانه فجمله أنت الذي سترت ما يعيبني وجدت لي.
بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ما بعد. So we now resume with our tafsir of Surah Al-Kahf, and we had mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatens those who reject Him with the punishment. Now, throughout the Quran, we always see after threats come rewards, after threats come promises, after adab comes rahmah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to leave us with a pessimistic note, with something that is only anger and threat. Always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pairs together His anger with His mercy. Allah says in the Quran, اعلموا أن الله شديد العقاب وأن الله غفور الرحيم. Know that Allah is severe in punishment and He's also forgiving and merciful. So both of these are there. So right after threatening those who reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the next verse, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِنُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ نُزُلًا. Those who do good, those who believe and do good, they shall have jannat, plural of jannah. Where? In Firdaus. Nuzula, as a place to live, as a place of residence. Now, notice here, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions two conditions to get up there. Number one, Iman. Number two, Amalus Salih. And these two conditions are paired together in over 70 verses in the Quran. Brothers and sisters, pay attention to this point. Never in the Quran does Allah praise Iman without Amal. Never in the Quran does Allah praise Iman without Amal. Why? Because Iman without Amal is not really Iman. Iman without Amal is not really Iman. If you truly believed in something and you genuinely had a love for something, that would cause you to act. If you knew your family was in danger, and you love your family, and you're capable to do something to save them, it is humanly impossible to do nothing and let your family perish. It's not possible to imagine this situation. So how about love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How about fear of Allah's punishment? How about hope in Allah's reward? You see, this is human nature. It's not even aqidah. It's not even theology. When you truly believe in something, you will act in accordance with that belief. So Iman must be followed by, must be accompanied by amal. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِنُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And this negates that type of philosophy that we find among some groups of other religions, and unfortunately it has been imported to Islam. That the person will say, if he doesn't pray, he doesn't fast, oh, don't worry brother, my heart is good. My heart is clean. Allah knows my iman is over here. Subhanallah, this is a false lie that the person has tricked himself. Shaitan has tricked himself into believing. And if iman without amal would have been of any value, then the best candidate would be none other than Iblis himself. Because Iblis, think about this, is a believer. Don't misquote me. I'm talking English. I didn't say he's a mu'min. He's a believer. Think about this. Does Iblis believe in Allah? Yes or no? Yes. Yes. Does he believe in Allah's power? Does he believe in Yawm al-Qiyamah? Does he believe Allah sends prophets? Does he believe Allah sends books? So then why is he not a believer with a capital B or a mu'min? He's a believer with a small b. Means he believes in Allah, in the prophet. Did not Iblis say, oh my Lord, allow me to live until the day of judgment? So he's affirming Allah to be his Rabb. And he's affirming there's a day of judgment. And he's affirming Allah's power because he's making dua to Allah. So why is he not a believer? Why? Because when Allah told him do, he said, I will not do. He refused to what? Act. Not believe. Act. So in Islam, Iman and Amal al-Salih are always paired together. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Where shall they be? كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ. They will have many jannat. Where? In Firdaus. Now, this is a beautiful point here. Jannatul Firdaus, we have all heard it is the highest jannah. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the Firdaus is wasat al-jannah wa a'la al-jannah. Firdaus is the middle of Jannah and it is the tip of Jannah. So from this our scholars have derived that Jannah is shaped somewhat like a pyramid, meaning the higher up you go, the fewer the people there. Right? So Firdaus is the wasat and the a'la, the pinnacle. Firdaus is the middle and it's also the highest. So therefore the lower you go, it will get bigger and wider. Right? So somewhat like a triangular shape. It's going upwards. So Firdaus is a'la al-jannah wa wasat al-jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, and it is beneath the arsh of Ar-Rahman, and the throne of Ar-Rahman is the roof of Firdaus. So the throne, there's nothing higher than Firdaus. There's nothing higher than Firdaus. By the way, just a bit tangent here. Firdaus, it actually comes from ancient Persian, ancient Farsi. And from this as well, it has made its way into English. And we call Firdaus in English, paradise. Paradise, Firdaus, is the same root. Think about it. So paradise, the English word paradise, it comes from this ancient Persian word. And similarly, the Arabic Firdaus, it also comes from this word. And there are many words in the Quran that are of non-Arabic origin, but the Arabs have used them and the Arabs have acquired them and the Arabs have made them a part of Arabic. This is the way of all languages. Every single language, it takes from other languages. Every language, it incorporates words from other languages. So Arabs as well, they took from Sanskrit, they took from Latin as well. So the word story and asatir, history and asatir, they took from Persian. So this is Firdaus, which is the English equivalent of paradise. But for us, Firdaus is not just any paradise. It is the highest paradise. It is the highest level of paradise. And our Prophet ﷺ said that in a hadith Qudsi, that in that level of paradise, Allah has said, it's a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah has said, I have created for my chosen servants what the eyes have never seen, and the ears have never heard, and the imagination has never conceived. The rest of Jannah, we are tempted with. There are beautiful grapes over there. There's beautiful pomegranates over there. There's Jannat over there. There's Hurun Ain. We are given a picture. The highest level, there is no picture to draw. The highest level, beyond imagination. Even if somebody could describe it, our minds could not conceive of it. Whatever descriptions exist, these are of the lower levels of Jannah. The highest levels, which is Jannatul Firdaus, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the hadith Qudsi? That in it are that which the eyes have not seen, the ears have not heard. وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. The man has never even thought of such things. And in another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah has planted the trees of Firdaus with his own hands. Allah has planted the trees of Firdaus with his own hands. Now, look at the ayah. Those who believe and do good will have many Jannat in Firdaus as a place to reside. Question. Those who believe and do good, will all of them get to Firdaus? No. Yet Allah is saying, those who believe and do good will have many Jannat in Firdaus. And we know for a fact that not all believers will get up there. We know this is of the elite, this is the highest level. So why then did Allah say, those who believe and do good will have Jannatul Firdaus, when only a small percentage will get there? The response, those who get there will not have any tricks. There's no secret. It's the same thing that all of us are doing, but they're doing it better quality and better quantity. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. It's not as if they have some magical superpowers. It's not as if they've discovered some secrets. It's not as if they have something outside of the book. No. They're doing exactly what all of us know we have to do. Pray and fast and be righteous and have taqwa and give charity and. It's the same. آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. But they're doing it with true iman. And they're doing the amal with the quality and quantity that is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because you see, brothers and sisters, after a while, you reach a point where you cannot increase in your actions. How many juz a day can you pray? How many days can you fast? Once every second day, the fast of Dawood. How much charity can you give? You still need to pay rent and take care of your family. There comes a point in time, frankly, we have not reached that level, but some of us, inshallah, there comes a point in time where you cannot go more. So then what is the difference? That is where it is the quality. It is the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not the quantity. Al-Hasan al-Basri, he said, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did not win you in the race because of the quantity of his deeds. Now, by the way, he's speaking to the tabi'un. They are praying tahajjud every night and reading Quran every week. That's their level. He didn't precede you by something of the quantity of his deeds, but it was something that Allah gave that settled in his heart. Now, when you get to that level, then you can say iman is going to be increased in the heart only. Once you get max out, basically, when you max out your actions, then there is a ta'alluq with Allah. There is a ihsan, the relationship that Allah is watching me. And that will happen to the elite. So those who get to Firdaus, they don't have some shortcut. They don't have some extra knowledge. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعْمِنُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. The same door for all of us. They shall have Jannatul Firdaus as a place to live. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. They will be in it forever. لَا يَبْغُونَ عَنْهَا حِوَلًا. They will never want to move away from it. And in this is a beautiful nukta, a latifa, an interesting point here. No matter how great of a thing we have, eventually we get tired of it. This is human nature. And wallahi, every one of you has experienced this in your own life. You're daydreaming of a car. I want this car, I want this car, I want this car. 2, 3, 4 years, you get that car. Alhamdulillah, for 1 week, 2 weeks, you're on cloud nine. Then all of a sudden, you notice another car in the parking lot. And you're like, I want that one now. Right? House, same thing. Wife, no, that never happens. Wife, mashallah, tabarakallah. It only goes more and more, alhamdulillah. But every blessing, we always have this, that subhanAllah, we want something else. We want something other. It's human nature. However, Firdaus, Allah is saying, no matter how long they are there, and this is something, think about it. How long can you remain in a mansion? How long can you remain in a palace? How long can you drive the same car? After a while, you get tired, but not in Firdaus. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا لَا يَبْغُونَ عَنْهَا حِوَلًا. They never want to move away from Firdaus. And this shows us that the pleasures will be eternal. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes the surah. قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ الْبَحْرُ مِدَادًا لِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّي لَنَفِدَ الْبَحْرُ قَبْلَ أَن تَنْفَدَ كَلِمَاتُ رَبِّي وَلَوْ جِئْنَا بِمِثْلِهِ مَدَدًا. Say, if all of the oceans were the ink for the writing of the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of this ink would be diminished and finished. لَنَفِدَ الْبَحْرُ. All of the oceans would finish up before the speech of Allah finishes. And even if Allah doubled all of those oceans again, still the ink would continue to finish and the speech of Allah would be infinite. And this, it is said that one of the reasons this verse was revealed was that some of the Banu Nadir in Medina, they complained to the Quraysh that how come your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that, how come the Prophet in Mecca, he says that, the knowledge of Allah is more than the Torah, when the Torah is all that we need and the Torah has everything that we have. We don't need anything more than the Torah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that the knowledge of Allah is infinite and whatever knowledge we have been given is very little. And Allah underscored this point in a verse that was directed directly to them. When they asked about the ruh, the spirit, what did Allah say? They ask you about the spirit. Say, the spirit is from the command of your Lord. And وَمَا أُوتِيتُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. What have you been given of knowledge except a very small amount? وَمَا أُوتِيتُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. So Allah is saying, my knowledge is infinite. You cannot compete with my knowledge. In another verse in Surah Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, say, if all of the trees of this world were to become pens, and all of the oceans were to become ink, then still all of this would perish and the speech of Allah would still continue. So it doesn't matter, the speech of Allah is infinite. And it doesn't matter how much ink or how much pens we have, but the knowledge of Allah and the speech of Allah will remain forever. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concluding this surah by telling us, look, I've given you some knowledge you didn't have. Dhul Qarnayn, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, the people of the cave, Khidr and Musa. But the fact of the matter is, the knowledge that I have is more than you can ever encompass. You will never have all of that knowledge. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes the verse that after telling people that Allah Azza wa Jal has so much knowledge, then they are reminded, who is this man who is telling you this knowledge? This man who is telling you the answers to your questions. He has given you this answer. Who is Dhul Qarnayn? Who is Ya'juj and Ma'juj? What is the Ruh? Who are the Ashab al-Kahf? He has told you all of this, but never forget, Ya Rasulullah, you go tell them, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Say, I am a human like you. This knowledge is not from me.
I'm not the one giving you this knowledge. I am but a human being. إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. And this is, as we know, a very common sequence in the Quran. It comes at least 4 or 5 times. إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Our Prophet ﷺ was a human being. He ate what the people ate. He got angry like the people got angry. He got hot with the sun and he would cover himself. He got married and he had children. He walked in the suq. He purchased and he bought. Like all of us, he was born and he passed away. This is our Prophet ﷺ. He is a human being. But what makes him special? Yuha ilayya. This is what makes him special. Not that he has divine powers, but that Allah has chosen him to be the recipient of direct communication. Yuha ilayya. Allah has inspired me. And what is the main thrust of this inspiration? Annama ilahukum ilahun wahid. That indeed you have one deity that is worthy of worship. This is the gist of Islam, the essence of all revelations. La ilaha illallah. This is the purpose of the whole Quran being coming down. So, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ. Whoever truly wants the mercy of his Lord, فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. Let him do good. وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. And let him not associate anyone in the good that he is doing. Once again, the same two conditions, iman and عمل الصالح. Once again, we have, you have to do good, and your ikhlas has to be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this ayah, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used it to talk about not worshipping idols. He used this to talk about minor shirk. And minor shirk means a Muslim who does a good deed for the sake of Allah, but his intention is polluted. And he wants to show off that good deed to other people. And this ayah tells us that if you want to show off your deed, you want to show off your praying, mashallah, tabarakallah, your fasting, anafil fast, your giving charity. If your niyyah is to show off, then this ayah applies to you. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, if you truly want Allah's blessings, then do good deeds and don't take anyone as a partner besides Allah. And a part of being a partner is to want reward, spiritual reward of a good deed from someone else. And that is why when we do any deed of ibadah, of salah, of sadaqah, of sawm, any good deed, we must monitor our intentions. Make sure that it is only fi sabilillahi ta'ala. And if we find our intention is being corrupted, immediately we need to turn to Allah, seek refuge in Allah. We say, a'udhu billah. We say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika shay'an wa ana a'lamu wa astaghfiruka lima la a'lamu. This is the dua that our Prophet ﷺ taught to Abu Bakr, that if you feel you're showing off, then make this dua. Allah will remove that showing off. So we make dua to Allah for ikhlas. We always monitor that we're doing something purely fi sabilillah, and the topic of showing off and riya is a long one. But the verse concludes by reminding us that if you truly believe in these promises of Allah, then these promises will be true and will be given to you as long as you do good and as long as you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, in our next khatira, we will summarize, that's the final khatira, we'll summarize some of the main lessons of Surah Al-Kahf, and we will continue inshallah tomorrow. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لا يزال الخير حيا لا يزال إن في الدنيا سلاما وظلال أخبر الأيام أنها في وصال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال